To the glory of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I wasn't with you last week. Last week, if you weren't here, you missed it too. The Reverend David Browder came to preach from Houston, Texas, from St. Thomas Church. And he told this congregation about everything his people were going through following the horrific flooding of Hurricane Harvey. At the same time he was standing here speaking to you, I was there speaking to his people in Houston. I had gone in there in a kind of a pulpit swap, and I was bringing his people the love of All Saints Parish here and telling them that we cared for them, carrying with me artwork from our Sunday school students so that everyone who came to church at St. Thomas last week received a piece of art from one of our children. Some of them were really funny, some of them were the way kids see things. And I handed one old lady a thing where it's a house that a kid drew where the house had fallen down, and underneath it said, "I'm sorry your house blew away." And you would think that she'd be upset by the drama of it. The woman was delighted and laughed out loud. It was funny to see things through a child's eyes. Well, when I got there and I was in Houston, I learned that many people were unaffected by the floods, but others were utterly devastated. An 81-year-old man told me that his home of 43 years was gone. What do I do now? I hugged him and we talked. Another couple had been in their home for 3 months and the home is gone. From the sublime to the ridiculous, from one end to the other, here we see both the extremes. But what I noticed among all of it was their heart. As I began to preach to them, many in the congregation began to weep and cry. And it wasn't because I was being emotive by what I was saying, as much as they were fragile and tenderhearted. And the fact that I would come and bring any love at all, such as I was bringing, including the gifts that you all put together for me to take to them, was overwhelming and beautiful in their sight. And they felt it and they were moved by it. And I noticed as I was talking to them, the limitless nature with which they were serving one another. There was no limit to the way they were helping one another, the sacrifices. Come and stay at my house. Here, I'll bring food to you. Don't worry, I'll pay that bill for you. Whatever it was, they were doing everything it took to love one another. And of course, it's not just Houston, it's Louisiana, Mexico City, Puerto Rico, Florida, the American West, all these places. My goodness, Las Vegas, all the places where tragedies and disasters have occurred. And I began to think about it as I heard what was being read from the lectern by the Apostle Paul. Because the Apostle Paul is a man who had gone through great tragedies. We know that he had been beaten, shipwrecked, jailed, flogged. He was given every sort of treatment possible. He was here writing this letter to the Philippians today from a house arrest in Rome, where he probably was not feeling well and was wondering, am I going to be executed? Is this the end? Am I dying now? Am I going to be put to my death? In addition to doing those things and going through those trials and tribulations, though, Paul had accomplished enormous things for the gospel in his life. He was a man who had converted entire cities, had started and planted churches, had written as many as 12 or 13 epistles of the New Testament, depending on how you count them and who you are theologically. He is someone who had unbelievable impact on the Christian world, explained and established doctrines that we're still teaching in the church and we will teach for as long as there is Christianity. He was perhaps the greatest Christian who ever lived, and he had perhaps lived the most victorious life of anybody who ever was baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. That's who Paul was. And at this point in his life, he's in this imprisonment, you think he would say, "I surrender. Had enough. I'm going to retire. Somebody get me a Winnebago. I'm going out west and I'm going to take it easy in the American parks." He certainly earned the right to stop. And by all means of accomplishment on one hand, and exhaustion and trouble and beatings on the other hand, he should have thrown in the towel and said, "I'm finished." But what did he say instead? You heard it. You heard it from the lectern. What did he say? He said, "This one thing I do." One thing. Not these 10 things. Here's my list. Go to Home Depot. Go to the post office. Feed the cat. This one thing I do with my life is I forget everything that's behind me. All my accomplishments. And oh my goodness, his accomplishments. All my tragedies and tribulations. And oh my goodness, did he suffer in the name of the Lord. As Jesus had told Ananias in the 9th chapter of Acts that he would suffer. He had suffered all this. I'm forgetting all that. It doesn't matter. And instead, I'm pressing forward. I'm striving forward. I'm going forward with zeal to what lies ahead. I'm heading for the goal line, for the finish line. And he gave us this imagery of a race. He's in a race, and he's not stopping. He's going to the finish line. He's going across the goal line. And what was the goal line he was going to? Intimate relationship with Jesus Christ. The goal line was to know Jesus, to live Jesus, to breathe Jesus, to serve the kingdom of God in Jesus' holy name so that others could find the eternal life and the forgiveness of sins that Paul had found in his Savior. He's striving to that goal line. He's not giving up, although no one on earth would ever have blamed him, but I dare say some in heaven might have. He wanted to reach that goal line. Why? Because in that goal line was a prize. There was a trophy, and that trophy was the upward call of God in Jesus Christ. He wanted that trophy. Now, before we go any further, I have to kind of disabuse you of something. You could run afoul here and think that Paul was saying, if you run hard and complete the race, you get eternal life. He was not saying that. Paul is the last person on earth to say that. He's the great expositor of the notion that grace, a free gift, gives you eternal life. Your eternal life comes as a free gift. And Paul isn't saying he's doing these things so he can earn eternal life. Quite the opposite, he's saying that he's running gladly because of eternal life. I am so grateful. I am so humble to my Lord. I want to give him my life and everything I have. In short, I want to live without limits. There's no limitation. Not the beatings, not the arrests, not the illness, not the accomplishments, nothing. There's no limitation. I am going forward and seeking with zeal the prize that God gives me to be found in Jesus Christ. And I'll attain it by reaching the goal of knowing Jesus and loving him and serving him and expounding his gospel to anybody who will hear it so the kingdom of God may be abounding here in this world. It's Paul's secret of life, if you would, to finish the race in Jesus Christ. Now, I talked to you about living without limits. That Paul is saying he's living without limits. He's not going to stop. But a lot of us in our lives play it safe. We live lives that are played safe. We want to be safe and sound. We don't want to live without limits. But there's a price for that. First off, I'll tell you that playing it safe and playing it safe and sound is sometimes wise. That's the wisdom sometimes that comes from God. There are things in the Bible, if you read them, say, in these circumstances, pull back. Whoa, pull back. Play it safe. Don't go into those situations, rock and roll, and you get your head chopped off. Play it safe in these circumstances. But they are exceptions. They are not your default mode. It's not the way to live your life. It's a way to pull back sometimes because you recognize there's a snake ahead that's going to bite you, so we play it safe. But the way we live our lives is to go without limits. We are called that way in Christ. It is something that you will regret dearly on your deathbed if you play it safe all your life as a philosophy and a means of life. Because by playing it safe, you're never going to have the fulfillment of life that you are wired by God to have. You're never going to glorify God to the fullest because by playing it safe, you're kind of laying back and letting others do it, or it's just not getting it done. And you're going to have a regret. You're going to regret it. You're going to be there at the end of your life and say, you know, I never hit that high note. Never hit that high note on that trumpet, so to speak, symbolically. Never hit that big home run in my life. Never had that big moment where I really did something for the Lord where I know it and I felt great about it. And you're going to have a regret. I remember seeing in a movie once where somebody was teaching another person, a wiser, older man was teaching a younger man, and he said, remember this, having a regret is worse than being a loser. It's better to do something and lose and go crashing and burning than it is to have the regret of never trying to do it in the first place. If I go out for the Lord and I risk something boldly and I smash into the ground and I blow it, you know what he's going to do? Well done, good and faithful servant. You tried to get up. Let me dust you off. Go back in there. Try again, son. You could do it. And I go back in and I do it. I just keep fighting and going for the Lord like Paul did. He was whipped and beaten and thrown in jail. Time to say, I quit. Not Paul. He presses on. He forgets what's behind. He's pressing on because accepting Jesus Christ and the goal of knowing him and loving him, there is no glory in this world. There is no life like that. If you adopt playing it safe, if you adopt philosophy of life of being safe and sound and measured and cool. You are never going to grow in your faith, your spirit, nor your character. You get that? When you play it safe, you don't grow. You say, okay, I'll just stay right here, it's good. And it's okay, I can't deny, it'll be okay. But you're not gonna grow like Paul did and be a lion that roars for the gospel. Your spirit's not gonna grow, your character's gonna be frozen. If anything, it'll shrivel in the shadows of the darkness of the place where you've chosen to play it safe. That's no way of life. You weren't born to be timid cowards in the shadows somewhere. You were born to stand up and proclaim the name of Christ. You were born to stand strong in the gospel and tell the world the good news of forgiveness and eternal life that's found in Jesus and Jesus alone. There's no other way in the world to get it. And if that's the price you pay for living your life safely, then what you really realize is that playing it safe is the riskiest thing you can do. The riskiest thing, because you risk your spirit, you risk your faith, you risk your character, they get frozen in some immature adolescent stage, and you never get past that. Huh. Safe and sound may be a comfortable way to go, but I have learned, and this is something I've learned in my own life, and you can probably tell me in your life too, that God and His kingdom work calls me constantly to risk discomfort and even suffering. Right? I'm not playing a martyr, but a lot of times in my Christian walk, I suffer. I'm uncomfortable. There's risk and I'm scared. I'm worried about this. Thing's getting risky now. But when He does that, He's calling me to the way He wants me to be. He wants me to lean over. I've given you that example before where He wants you to lean over on His holy word and His promises so much that if they're not true, you'll fall flat on your face. Remember that example I would give you? I'd say, look, I'm leaning on this wall, right? I'm leaning over on it. Now, if this wall is strong and it's true, I'm going to be just fine. But if it's false and it's not what it says it is or looks like what it is, I'm going to fall flat on my face. And that's the way God wants us to live, leaning on His promises, leaning on His word, getting out over the edge so that the gospel can be advanced. So my spirit will grow, my faith will grow, my character will grow, and now I'm useful to God. Maybe I'm not Paul, but I'm better than I was. I'm somebody that He could use and send out there in tough situations. Everybody likes stories. Children like stories. We grow up, we like stories. We read books. We go see movies. We like sports and we go to games. And when you think about it, why do we like stories, movies, plays, games so much? Why do we like them? Start with like movies and books and all. Why do we like them? Because we can vicariously live our lives watching the protagonist in the story go through the great adventures of whatever was written. Or in a movie, watch the great action hero do things we'd love to do and swing on a rope and save somebody and shoot the bad guys and ride away or whatever it is. We thrill to that. We watch baseball games, football games. Last night the Nationals were on. Heroic comeback in the eighth inning, five runs. Oh, it's a rush. And you feel the blood coursing through you and the adrenaline is flowing and you're excited and your heart is pounding. And you love it. That's why you tuned in. That's why you paid for your season's tickets. You want that rush in your life. Do you know why? Because you were made to be that way. God made you to exhilarate in those thrills so that you would live it out in the way you live your life and the taking of risks in your community and helping the people who live next door and telling somebody something they need and saving a child from distress and serving and doing whatever it is you're called to do. We were made to be that way and live wide open, without limit, and fearlessly. That's how I was made. And that's how you were made. And I've lived my life both ways. As a younger man, when I was a lawyer and the things I did, I lived one way. Then I found out that by letting everything go and working for the Lord, it was the highest and best. There's nothing that you can improve on the life that God gives us when we live without limits in the kingdom. We like powerful music, right? Like that music? Boom, 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 boom. And it's a heart starter, right? Hear the organ go and the choir sings, and it's a big thing. Wow. And I appreciate a choir today because last week when I was at St. Thomas, we were worshiping outside because they can't go in their church from the flood. And they were trying to worship. The choir, though, was giving it their best and trying to sound as loud as they could with the trucks and the cars going by on the road in front of the church. Then they come back and hear our choir thundering here. And that kind of thing stirs my soul. It stirs my heart. I like powerful music. I like amusement park rides. I like those things just like the books and the movies and the stories. And why do I like them? Because when I'm on an amusement park ride, for example, I'm thrilled, yet I'm safe. That roller coaster gives me a thrill. There's really not much danger in it. I know people sometimes get hurt, but by and large, a million people ride a roller coaster and nobody gets hurt. Right? So I love that because I can have the thrill with and still be safe at the same time. They make me feel alive. They feel something like what God wants me to feel, and they tell me something about the way God made me. There's an old saying that a ship, a great sailing ship, is safe in a harbor. But that's not what the ship was made to do. The ship was made to go out on the high seas, to go do great adventures, to carry cargo to South America, to carry passengers to Africa. The ship was made to do great and mighty things, even to withstand storms out in the ocean. Yeah, the ship is very safe in the harbor, not what it was made to do. Likewise, I'm very safe when I stay on the sidelines. Stay away from the heat of the fire. Stay away from the Holy Spirit glow, saying, get in there and do your part for the gospel. Get in there and raise up and do what you could do. I'm very safe when I don't do that. But it's not what I was made to do. God made me to do other things. I was made to live without limits. And why was I made to live without limits? Because God's kingdom is made without limits. God has no limits. I'm made in his image. Obviously, I'm made to live without limits, to give him my all, to give him everything. Kingdom people, the people of God and God's kingdom, are brought along to love others without limits. As I saw in Houston, with those people loving one another, loving without limits. But we were also called to serve without limits, to pray without limits, to sacrifice without limits, to give without limits, and yes, even to die without limits. It'd be to my great glory to die for the Lord. I don't want to die. I'm not looking to die. I want to live to proper old age. But if I had to lay my life down for the Lord, okay, Father, you could have that too. And not because I'm some big hero, but I'm that grateful. I'm grateful for you, Father. You gave me eternal life in your Son. You got me. What do you want me? Take me. Take me. I don't account for this life as much anyway. I'm here only for, what, 60, 70, 80, 90 years, whatever you get to live. We had a woman be 100 in our church. We celebrated her birthday 2 weeks ago. Louise Bernhardt was 100. It was magnificent. But even that, we're getting to the end, aren't we there? So I say to the Lord, take what you want from me now. I have eternity to live in comfort with you. In Matthew 21 today, Jesus says, therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to people that produce the fruits of the kingdom. Jesus is saying in the gospel today, if you're not going to live without limits, if you're going to play it safe like the Pharisees did in the gospel today, if you're going to live by the hierarchy and the rules and have everything comfortable where you can measure it out and you can keep it something predictable and something that's not leaving you insecure, then I'm going to take it away from you and give it to somebody who's willing to live without limits. Somebody who's willing to burn it all for me. Somebody who's willing to give everything and go with it. I often encounter people who won't do it. They're kind of stuck in life. Some of them are stuck for different reasons. But there's one category of people I've learned about. It's a category of people who are unyielding, stubborn, irascible, hard to get along with, hard shell. So when you come up to them, they scowl and scare you off. And you say, ooh, I'm not going near that guy again. When I was a kid, I was terrified of those people. We had old guys in my neighborhood. You go into their store or you go up into their neighborhood or on their front lawn and they would just give you grief and be really tough. Everybody's afraid to go to those people. Man, that guy's strong. He's tough. He's not strong and tough. As I got older, I have zero fear of those people now. I figured them out. I figured out this. I've learned that they're not so tough. I've learned that instead, they are terrified and scared inside. They are terrified of getting out of playing it safe. They're terrified of doing the things that might have to be done if I have to be touchy-feeling emotional with you, if I have to let my soul be intimate with your soul, if you ask me to give of myself and to step out of myself. So by putting on this hard shell, gruff countenance, what I'm really doing is putting up an elaborate defense mechanism. so you can't get to me. And what happens is they wither and they die. They live like ostriches with their heads in the sand instead of flying like eagles. And to that, Isaiah 40 tells us, those who wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And some of us are those eagles. We're called to fly, to soar as Christians. Playing it safe sometimes. I told you, wisdom sometimes says play it safe. But by and large, living a lifestyle of wide open. And I'll admit to you right up front, giving yourself over to kingdom life can be scary. You want to live a life in the kingdom of God and walk with Jesus and his gospel? It can be scary, risky, dangerous to you. You could lose a lot by doing that. It could be unsafe and even terrifying. Here's the qualifier. Even terrifying. Here's the qualifier. At first. At first. And then you learn by walking in it, I can do this with the Lord. I can do this by the power of the Holy Spirit. I'm not alone. It's what Paul learned. That's why Paul said, go ahead and beat me. Throw me in jail. Do what you want. And I've done all these things. Nothing matters. I still got the Holy Spirit. I press forward to the goal of knowing Jesus more intimately and knowing him in the beauty of life. And it's important that we do because people are in poverty. And I don't mean poverty of money, although that too. I mean poverty of spirit, poverty of hope, of joy, of fellowship, of love, of laughter, of forgiveness. And they need us, you and me, the people of Jesus and the kingdom of God, to come to them and take care of our church and build up our church big and invest our lives, our money, our being, our sacrifices, and everything we have into this. And you will lose doing this sometimes. I have crashed mightily face first into the floor. The Apostle Paul was whipped and put in jail. You will crash doing this sometimes. But as I was saying to you before, the Lord will lift you up and he will reward you. The other thing, finally, is this. If you think you're going to play it safe, there's no safe place in the world to stand. This world is the world. You'll be safe in heaven, I'm sure. But in this world, no place to escape disease and illness, no place to escape problems, bad weather, terrorism. There's no safe place. Let me play it safe. Show me your safe place. There's no safe place. But don't be depressed about that. I'm not saying it to you so that you'll feel bad. I'm trying to give you a bad news feeling here. I'm saying it to you factually so you can be smart and sharp and say, okay, I get it. There is no safe place. I need to live wide open and go against it, all for the glory of God and for my fulfillment. So when you get like Paul, you hit old age and illness, you're to look it in the eye and say, excuse me, but I need to press on. Bankruptcy, depression, excuse me, I need to press on for the forward, to be forward. You've hit your high, you've been successful, you've scored your thing, you've hit the high note, you've rung the bell. Excuse me, I don't care about that, that's behind me. I've got to press on. Bad health, broken relationships, I don't care what it is. Excuse me, I've got to press on. Because I am to live without limits, because the kingdom of God is without limits. And Jesus Christ, who calls me, gives me his Holy Spirit to live that way. I was wired by God with a computer chip to live that way. And when I live that way, I feel fulfilled. I feel like everything is what it should be. And when I don't, something's not right, and my shoulder hurts, and I'm bored today, and I need something. So as you leave here today, and Sunday becomes Monday, start checking yourself, looking where you're drawing a line in the sand and say, no, I'm going to live without limits. And when you do, not only will you feel the fulfillment of life you've probably been seeking for decades, but the Lord Jesus Christ will be glorified and you will be rewarded in every good way. And for that we say, thanks be to God and amen.